wherever you are, I want you to stand to your feet. Everybody in this building, stand to your feet. When a king comes into a room, you stand up. How many of you know that the King of Glory is here today? Hallelujah. Woo, shit. Yes, God. Yes, God. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. There's a difference between grace and mercy. We use them interchangeably oftentimes, but there is a difference between grace and mercy. Grace is giving you that which you did not deserve. How many of you are glad that he gave you grace? If you're saved, shout, I'm saved today, Pastor. Shout it, shout it, shout it, shout, I'm saved today. Shout it, I'm saved today. That's grace. How many even know what it means to walk in doors that you know you shouldn't even be in the room? Somebody shout, that's grace, that's grace. But mercy. You see, grace is God giving that. Ushe matinayama. Grace has given us that which we did not deserve. But mercy, y'all, is God not giving us what we sure enough deserve. You didn't hear nothing I just said. Mercy is God saying, I know you're supposed to die in this. I know you're supposed to have cancer. I know you're supposed to have AIDS. I know you should have lost your car and lost your house and lost your mind. Because you put yourself in a predicament that the consequences deem that you should die in it. But mercy says, although they deserve it, I'm going to put me and my son in between their wrath. I need somebody here. Don't shout because of mercy. Because of grace. I need you to shout because God gave you mercy. And although your life is not everything you want it to be, if he hadn't have given us his mercy, it would be so much worse. Take 30 seconds and give God the best praise you've got. Because his mercy, hey, carabosa, endure forever. Hallelujah. I need you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm about to shout, and it might get on your nerves. But if you knew what I've been through, you wouldn't look at me. You would shout with me. Now push him and tell him, scoot over some. It's about to go down. Oh, yeah. Now shout. Like you know that God has been good to you. Shout like you know that God has turned your life around. Shout like you know that you will be 6 feet under if God hadn't a stunt. Woo! Yeah. I need you to shout like you know cancer would be in your body right now if God hadn't have snatched it out. Shout right like you know that if God hadn't have stepped in right in time, you would have been on your way to hell. Shout! Woo!
Without the instruments.
Son, you were right. Great is thy faithful. Come on, we ain't been faithful to him, but he's sure enough been faithful to us. After all you've been through. I know it's a little crowded in here today. I got that. It's a little crowded today. So for all of you that need a breakthrough, not next year, not next month, not next week, but you need it today, just tell your neighbor, scoot over some. I need to get out in the aisles and get my praise on. When I count to three, I want everybody else to praise God like you lost your mind. Lift your hands, or we're going to just shout for the rest of the service. Woo. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, tell me where would. Come on, y'all know that. That's old school. Where would I be? Sing that again. Come on.
If it had not
come on, trauma.
Been for the Lord on my side, tell me.
Tell me where would I instruments. Come on.
If it has not been.
Let me hear them. That is. Y'all sound good today. That sound like a testimony. That don't even sound like a song. One more time. Take a deep breath. Let your neighbor know God's been good. Come on. If it had. Ooh, y'all sound good today. Tell me. Come on, take a brief and say it. Somebody ought to give him some praise. Father, if it had not been for you on our side, we don't know where we would be. We know where we wouldn't be. We wouldn't be sitting here today. We wouldn't be standing in this place. Many of us would just be waking up from a hangover right now. Sitting in some pod in a prison. In an alley with a syringe in our veins. Somewhere with a gun cocked towards our heads, wanting to blow our own brains out. Lord, we thank you that when we didn't love us, you loved us. When we wanted to die, you wanted us to live. Woo! When we wanted to kill ourselves, you stopped us from taking our lives. Give you glory. We give you honor. We're just reflecting on your goodness, God. We thank you. We believe it to be done. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, hallelujah. And thank you, Jesus. I need you to hug 7 people and tell them grace, 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 grace. Grace, grace, grace. Woo. Lord, have mercy. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Woo. So this is always the struggle. This is always the struggle that I have. When God does this, he messes the protocol of the service out up. And so we got videos and announcements, smoking stuff prepared. It's just like God's got us behind schedule. I was supposed to be preaching 18 minutes ago. But we will never be that church that gets so caught up in the protocol and the bulletin that we don't give the Lord, the Holy Ghost, the time to do what he wants to do. So if we don't seem smooth today, blame it on God, right? So scrap the videos. Media, just scrap it. We'll figure it out what to do with that later. All right, let's get into the word now. Take a few moments and let's just see what God does. All right. I need everybody just jump up and shout as loud as you can. Nobody but Jesus. Yeah.
Nobody but Jesus.
Come on, shout it again. Nobody but Jesus. Woo! All right, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it. All right, remain standing. Matthew 25. If I don't start reading or do something, y'all, Matthew 25. Woo. Matthew 25. Out of the Message Bible, starting at the 34th verse. Matthew 25, out of the Message Bible, starting at the 34th verse. For those of you that are visiting, we don't apologize. This is the presence of God. We thank God for you being here. And this is just the type of flow that the Lord has us in. And we're not embarrassed to be radical for Jesus. Yeah, amen. Amen. Thank God so much for you being here. My prayer is that you're already engaged in the things of God. Matthew 25, verse 34, everything you heard about us was true. Amen. Matthew 25, verse 34 and verse 35. Let's read it together as loud as you can. Matthew 25, verse 34 and verse 35. I'm going to do some teaching today. I'm glad we got our shout now. I need to get some teaching done. Matthew 25, verse 34. Let's read it as loud as you can. Let's read now. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Enter you who are blessed by my Father. Take what's coming to you in this kingdom. It's been ready." Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Today I'm starting a series called Compassion. Everybody say that. Compassion. I'm starting a series called Compassion in preparation of our huge Compassion Sunday that we're going to have October the 4th. So excited about that. Just really elated to be a part of what God is doing, not only here in the city of Knoxville, but how he has allowed us to engage in the world. I thank God that you all have allowed me to go to all different portions of the country and of the world to be able to do ministry and to impart the Overcoming Believers Church spirit in nations and generations. And just a little while, I'm not going to tell y'all when because y'all act real funny, but I'm on my way to Ghana. I'm on my way to Ghana this time. Last time I was in Kenya. Amen. Last time I was in Kenya, I'm on my way to Ghana. We're going to do a trip to Haiti. For any of you that would like to go, let my executive pastor know we're going to do a trip to Haiti and bless some people in that very impoverished country. I believe that this world needs the fingerprints of Overcoming Believers Church on it. And I believe that there is something good that has come out of Nazareth and Knoxville. I believe God has his hand on this ministry, and he does not have his hand just on me, but he has his hands on you. I oftentimes get a lot of credit across the country for what God is doing in our ministry, but I am very, very clear with anybody that talks about what God is doing with OBC in Knoxville that it is not me. It's the people of God that help hold the hands up of the man of God. And so I'm really excited about what's about to take place. If you look around the staging and even in King's Corridor, you saw signage that talked about Compassion Sunday. And so that's what I'm going to set this up. I'm going to set this up talking about compassion. Everybody say compassion. Say it again. The word compassion literally means to share in one's suffering. It does not mean to be empathetic or sympathetic. It literally means to share in one's suffering. And so when Jesus would go up to a person that was struggling with some type of disease, a virus or illness, when he walked up to a person that was leprous and they were dying, they literally were dying of that disease, not only did he feel sorry for them, but God had given him this divine inclination where he could literally feel the pain of the people that he was ministering to. It wasn't something that he was philanthropically engaged in, saying, man, I feel sorry for that poor man, or I feel sorry for that woman who has lost her child, or I feel sorry for Lazarus as he's died. No, Jesus had this inclination, this internal inclination, where he could literally feel the pain of what that individual was going through. And because Christ is now, his body is at the right-hand side of the Father making intercession for us, but his spirit is inside of each and every one of us, we should have that same compassion for those that are hurting and those that are weak and those that are marginal. God has called us, listen to this, my brothers and sisters, to be the hands of Jesus. Amen. Lift your hands up right now and look at them and tell your hands, you are the hands of Jesus. Now, what that simply means is whatever Jesus would place his hands on, you should be placing your hands on. Whatever would make Jesus weep, that should make you weep. Whatever would make Jesus burden for, you should have that same type of burden, because Christ is inside of you, which gives this world hope of his glory. And so God is trying to get us to transform our minds. Remember Romans, the 12th chapter, verse 2. And be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. He wants us to transform our minds, listen to this, from wanting things from God to be used as a vessel and a vehicle for God. He wants you, listen to this, to be the blessing instead of always praying for a blessing. And I don't know about you, but that's where I am in my maturity and my faith walk. My prayers have become different. I've changed the content and the characters of my prayer. I don't always pray this Santa Claus, this Christmas list prayer. God, give me this and God, give me that, and I'm going to need this and I'm going to need that. But now my prayer life has matured, and now I'm saying, God, bless my sister. She's going through all types of circumstances. Bless my ministry, because the people in it are struggling in certain situations. When I see a person whose marriage is falling apart, I'm like, God, help them pull that back together. I see a person that can't pay their light bills. We don't talk about them and say crazy stuff about them because they haven't paid their bill. No, we say, God, how can you use me to be a blessing to a person? Get these lights on. I don't want them to go through this embarrassment. How do I keep this man from losing his home and losing his family? Y'all with me? Anybody besides me, you know, you're in a different place now. You ain't playing them games no more in prayer, and you ain't at Maynard in prayer. Now you grown. You know what I'm saying? You grown. You praying big boy prayers, big girl prayers. You are wanting to be the hands of God. That's why God got to bless you. God got to bless you. You have to walk in increase. You have to walk in abundance. You have to walk in overflow, because not so that you can have it going on, but that you can have so much that not only are you blessed and your family's blessed, but anybody that God puts in your path, you got enough, come on, residual blessings to take. I dare you to look at somebody and tell them, you better love me, because I'm going to have enough blessings that's going to be able to bless everybody on my roll. You got to overflow. You've got to increase. You've got to walk in this anointing. So God is trying to transform us and transition us from needing a blessing to becoming a blessing. But in order for you to be able to walk in the benefits of your salvation, in order for you to be able to walk in the promises of God, that which God has ordained for you, you got to be like Jesus, y'all. You got to be like Jesus. And if you look at Jesus' prayer journal, he's not praying for stuff. He's praying for people. He's always praying for people, because that's the anointing that God had upon his life. Amen. Somebody shout, I want to be like Jesus. Well, if you want to be like Jesus, then you have to become the hands of God, because that's what Jesus was. The text that we just read in Matthew, the 25th chapter, verse 34 and 36, follows a passage in scripture that is absolutely scary. It's absolutely scary. We talked about this king, and we talked about how he says, come on in and be able to reap that which was already prepared for you. But before that, there was something that was spoken in Matthew 25 that's rough theologically, and it's rough in a very practical sense to even hear and to read. The Bible says that many came to Jesus. He said, many will come to my Father and say, God, did not I cast out demons in your name? Did not I preach the gospel in your name? Did not I work miracles in your name? Did not I do all of these supernatural exploits and signs and wonders in your name? But then the master will look back at the person who was in church all of his life, who shouted like we shouted and danced like we danced, and wore OBC t-shirts and spoke in tongues, and the master will say this back to that person: depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, I never knew you. Isn't that bothersome to you, that there will be people that went to church every Sunday, that was in vacation Bible school, that perhaps even taught the kids or even preached the gospel, and were able to get people out of their storm, but will find themselves caught in the storm themselves? Isn't that alarming to you, that God will allow you to have power and authority to destroy other people's yokes and remove other people's burdens and lift them up and preach them out of hell, but then allow you to walk straight into hell yourself? I don't know about you, but I don't want to go to hell thinking I was on my way to heaven. I don't want to go to hell thinking that my life was right with Jesus. I don't want to play church all my life. I don't want to do the religious thing. I want to have a real relationship with God. And the Bible teaches us, according to Matthew 25, as he begins to talk to us about soteriological things, salvific things, that this was not just about a person that was doing things that they shouldn't have done. That's one of the things that I think has been anchored in our spirits as it pertains to being lost, and as it pertains to living life of wickedness, that we have a flawed thought pattern about. We think that bad people are people that drink and people that smoke and people that have sex. But God says, yeah, that's sin, but it is also sin, listen to this, to not do what I called you to do. Okay. Come. So we spend all of our time talking about people that are doing things that they shouldn't be doing, and going places where they shouldn't be going, and saying things that they shouldn't say, and operating with people that in the ways that they shouldn't be operating in. And that is 100% true, but baby, that's half the story. There's a such thing as sin of commission and also sins of omission. And this passage is not about people who did things wrong. This passage is about people who didn't do things at all. So my question to you this morning is not what you're doing wrong. My question is, why aren't you doing anything right for Jesus? So here, this whole passage, Matthew 25, is a beautiful passage about what it means to be a real Christian. What does it mean to be a real Christian? A real Christian is a person that is the hands of God. That's the hands of God. Let me look at it again, Matthew 25, verse 34. Then the king will say to those on the right, enter you who are blessed by my Father. Take what's coming to you in this kingdom, all right? Now watch this. It's been ready for you since the world's foundation. Now this, the next couple of verses qualify to us why this person was able to enter into the kingdom and enter into the promises of God. It says it right there. And here's why. You see that? And here's why. Everybody say, here's why. Jesus says, I was hungry and you fed me. That's why you get to come into the kingdom. Because I was hungry and you did what? You fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was homeless and you gave me a room. Give me the next verse. I was shivering and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you did what? You stopped by the hospital and you visited me. I was in prison and you didn't buy the Just Busted magazine and show everybody. But you know what you did? You came by the prison. Even if I was wrong, you came by the prison and you came to see me. Are y'all listening to me? Give me the next verse. Watch this. Then those sheep are going to say, Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry? Jesus, we've been with you for 3.5 years. We never seen you hungry. I mean, when you got hungry, you took 2 fish and 5 barley loaves and you broke it and you ate. What are you talking about? You've never been hungry. When were you thirsty, Lord? You were able to turn water into wine. We never saw you thirsty. Look at here. Come on. Then those sheep. And when did we ever see you sick? We never saw you sick. You were healing other people. And in prison, when did we come to visit you in prison? You haven't even been in prison yet. Look what Jesus' reply is. Help me out, help me out, help me out. Look what Jesus' reply was. Then the king will say, I'm telling the solemn truth. Whenever you did one of these things to someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. Woo! You did it to who? To me. Everybody talk about they want to serve Jesus. I want to serve Jesus. I want to be a blessing to Jesus. I want to serve Jesus. You can't serve him. He in heaven. So you got to go to heaven if you want to serve him. He says, if you want to serve me, you serve the people who cannot serve themselves. Are you listening today? And so I want to teach you in just the next maybe 7 minutes very quickly on some principles, and I want to teach you about some concepts on what happens when you take care of the poor. And when I say the poor, I'm not talking about you. You think you poor. You are not poor. If you have never eaten out of the trash can, if you've never saw some roadkill and picked it up and fried it and served your children, you're not poor. If you haven't lived off of $300 a year, you're not poor. There are people that come to this city. As a matter of fact, I ran into some people out of Africa that have come to this city, and I was ministering to them, and they were living over in Waltapee. And I said, how do you feel about your living circumstances and situations, and how do you feel about it? And they said, this is the blessed place we've ever been in my life. It's like a penthouse to us, Pastor. And I say, why would you say that? Because I was living in a hut with 32 people. In a hut with 32 people. No lights, no food, no electricity, no inside bathrooms, a hut with 32 people. When I was in Kenya, I literally saw a little baby in a dump fighting. He had a stick in his hand, and he was fighting a buzzard over a banana peel. When I say poor, I'm not saying because you can't get the iPhone 6 Plus. I'm not talking about that. Just because you can't get your kids that new pair of Jordans that are out. That ain't what I'm talking about. I'm talking about poor. Like 98% of the people that live in this world outside of us, I'm talking about real poor. And God says that when you are serving the poor, you're really serving me. And so I want to give you some principles really quickly before I close today. All right, number one. When you serve the poor, it protects us from the curse. Put that up there. Can you type that in? Serving the poor protects us from the curse. Everybody say that with me. Serving the poor protects us from the curse. Say it again. Serving the poor protects us from the curse. Turn to Proverbs, the third chapter, verse 27. Proverbs, the third chapter, verse 27. Give it to me as fast as you can, scribes. Let's keep me in the message. Proverbs, the third chapter, verse 22nd, verse 27. Give it to me as fast as you can. All right? So when we serve the poor, when we give to the poor, we take care of those that are struggling in different lands, in different countries, and even here in our own country, the first thing that it does is it protects us from the curse. I need that up there. All right, Proverbs, the third chapter, verse 27. Look what it says. Never walk away from someone who deserves help, which means everybody don't deserve help. Okay, I ain't got time to deal with that. I ain't got time to deal with that. But everybody that asks you for some money, you ain't supposed to give it to them. All right? All right? But what when you know, because some people you think you're helping, you're really handicapping them, and they will never trust God because you're their God, because every time they need something, they come to you when they really need to bow down, start tithing, start giving, and doing right instead of spending all their money on weed. Can I get a witness? Okay. I'm sorry. Never walk away from someone who deserves what? Your hand is what? God's hand for that person. Now look at the next verse. Don't tell your neighbor, maybe some other time, or try me tomorrow when the money's right. And the money is right there in your pocket. In other words, don't say somebody come up to you and you know that they're struggling, you know they need help, they've been doing everything that they need to do in order to have some resources, but life is just hitting them. He says, don't say, you know what, I'll pray for you. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to ask the Lord and believe God that he's gonna prosper you and he's going to lift you up when you got everything you need in your right pocket. He said, don't do that, all right? I want to take you to another verse. All right? Proverbs 28, go to 28, verse 27. Talking about the consequences of serving poor and how God responds to us in serving the poor. All right? Proverbs, the 28th chapter. I want to look at verse 27. 28, verse 7. Let's read it together. Be generous to the poor. You'll never, everybody say never. Never. You will never do what? Shut your eyes to their needs and you'll run a gauntlet of curses. He says, if you give to the poor, I love this next word, you will never go hungry. Some people say, well, Pastor, I would give, man, but if I give my last, man, then what I'm going to have? The text says, if you give to the poor, you will never go hungry. When my wife and I, all of our life, we've practiced this. All of our life, all of our married lives, we practice this, and we still do to this day. Everybody comes up short every once in a while. Everybody hits those seasons where things get tight. Who in here, you don't have them ever. You never have a season where nothing gets tight. Because I need you to lay hands on everybody in here. I'm first. All right. So everybody has those seasons when things get tight. You know what happens, and this is I can say this emphatically in the pulpit without fear of judgment from the Holy Ghost. Anytime things get tight in my life, my wife and I get on a giving spree. We start giving, because we have learned in a very practical way that the only way to get out is to give out. We have learned that. And we don't allow people to make us feel bad because we live in a blessed life, because they see what we got, but they didn't see what we gave. And you got to be the same way. You got to say, look, you can say whatever you want to say. You see what I got, but you did not see what I gave. If you get that, shout, I got that. He said, if you turn your eyes the other way now, he said, you're going to run a gauntlet of curses. Curses come into your life when you don't give to those that are hurting. Number two. When we give to the poor, it pushes God to hear our prayer, all right? Proverbs 21, verse 13, all right? Out of the Message Bible, let's say that together. When we give to the poor, it pushes God to hear our cry. Proverbs 21, verse 13, look at this. It says, if you stop your ears to the cries of the poor, I don't hear that. You hear them crying and you just close your ears. If you stop your ears to the cries of the poor, your cry will go unheard and unanswered. So sometimes God challenges us. He tests us to see if we are mature enough to receive the next level of blessings. So sometimes we are believing God for greatness. We're believing God for the next level of increase. We're believing God for that business, or we're believing God to graduate, or we're believing God to bring our children out of whatever they're in. And God says, I don't even hear you, because every time I put somebody that's in need in front of you, you close your ear to them. And so what we've got to do is make sure that we understand that when we give to hurting people, and that doesn't just mean money. Sometimes it's teaching them how to read. It's sometimes it's giving them some clothes so they can be prepared to go into an interview. Sometimes it's protecting them from the weight of this world. Sometimes it's the single mother with four kids saying, girl, you need to go down to Gatlinburg this weekend. I'm going to give you 2 days at Gatlinburg, and I'm going to take those kids. Sometimes it's not just money, but it's effort, is sacrifice. He says, when you do that, it positions you and pushes God into a place where he hears your prayers. Are y'all listening to me? All right. Y'all getting this so far? We're almost finished. All right. Next thing, y'all gonna shout off this for real. Watch this. When we give to the poor, it positions us to receive currency. Anybody know what currency? Touch somebody and tell them that's Spanish for cash. Yeah, tell them that. Currency. Everybody say currency. Say it again, currency. Anybody would like to have some more currency? Anybody want some more monies? All right. I need to know those of you that are ready to walk in stupid increase. No, I'm talking about more money than you can count. I'm talking about make it rain for real. And I'm not this Facebook with a 20 and then 200 wands. I'm talking about real increase. All right? He says there's a way that you can operate in perpetual increase and get God's attention. Look at Proverbs 19, verse 17. Proverbs 19, verse 17. I don't know what church you've been at, and I don't know what you've been hearing, but God wants you to be paid. Okay, all right. Y'all can go to the poverty church down the street, all right? Y'all can, you know. I shop at the Goodwill because I want to, not because I have to. Can I get a witness up in here? Amen. There was a time that I had to, not now. They got some jazzy stuff in there, so I did, but hey. All right? So God wants you to have increase. You are not a better Christian just because you broke. That does not make you spiritual because you broke. No, you are not more spiritual because you can't get your hair done. The devil is a lie. God want all this to be straight too. Can I get a witness? Yeah. Now, how do I get finances into my life outside of tithing and giving offerings? Right here. Mercy to the needy is what? Is a loan to God. And God pays back loans in. God is not your cousin that keep talking about he gonna pay you back next Friday. I got you next Friday, bro. I got you. No, 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 no. If God ever asks you to sow into somebody's life, I don't want you to see it as some good act. When God says, I want you to sow into that person right there. Now listen to me. Sometimes God will call you to sow into people that look like they living better than you. Won't he do it, Pop? He'll say, I want you to sow in that person right there. And you're like, God, they in a Benz. And God said, did I ask you to look at their car? He says, I want you to sow into that person right there. And God says, I didn't ask you to ask me for an explanation. I just want you to be obedient. And when you do that, you got to say, okay, God, but I ain't giving it to that person. I'm going to lend to you. And God says, when you lend to me, I'm going to pay you back with good interest. With good interest, with good interest. And so when we give to the poor, when we give to those that are struggling, when we give to those who God has targeted us to sow into, God says, you're not just giving to the poor, you're lending to me. And when I pay back in full. Everybody say in full. All right? Now, let me hit this last one. All right? Let me hit this last one. The last one is, it portrays us as the image of Christ. When we give to the poor, 1 John 3, verse 16 scribes, when we give to the poor, it portrays us as the image of Christ. It testifies of God's love towards us. It speaks of what God has done to us and through us in salvation. All right? We're almost through. 1 John, the third chapter, verse 16. Let's read this together. This is beautiful. This is how we've come to understand and experience what? Now, how do we come to understand and experience love? Christ sacrificed his life for who? Isn't that awesome? He says, if you want real illustrated love, if you want to see the personification of what real love is, it's when you sacrifice your love, your life for somebody else. Don't you ever say God doesn't love me. That's what an insult it is to the heavenlies for you to say God just don't love me. He must not love me. How in the world can you say that when he gave you his best, which was his son, Jesus Christ? How many of you have children? Wave at me. How many of you would have allowed your child to die for me? Cut the lights up. Like, Pastor, I like you and all. I'm going to give you $50 on Pastor's anniversary, but I'm telling you, you ain't going to get Ray Ray. I promise you ain't going to get Ray Ray. You ain't getting Ray Ray. You ain't getting Pookie or Tamika and them. You ain't getting none of them. I like you. God says, watch this. I gave up my only son, watch this, for people that didn't even like me. The Bible says when we were yet sinners, he died for me. That's what you call sacrifice. When God gives his own son for people that didn't even like him. We were enemies of the cross, but yet God says, I'm going to give you my son anyway. You ought to pray. I need just praise God right there. Praise God right there. That God illustrated his love towards us when we were yet sinners, and he wanted to do it through sacrifice. Take me back up there. He wanted to do it through sacrifice. He said, now that's what I did for you. He says, but if you're going to be Christians now, I want you to do the same thing that I did for you to other people. Here it is. This is why we ought to live sacrificially for our fellow believers and not just be out for ourselves. Y'all, that's what I want you to pray this week. I want you to spend time with the Father this week, and I want you to begin to pray that because it's innate, it's natural, especially it's our wiring, number one, to be selfish and ingrown and always focused on what we can get for ourselves. But it also is connected to our culture, is where we live. We're Western, we're Christendom, but we're Christians, but we're Western. And in America, it's all about us. What can we get? You get one car, and then you want another car, and then you get one house, and you want a bigger house, and you get one outfit, you got to have another outfit. That's innate. It's natural to our carnal beings, but we are born again now. We have been bought with a Christ. We are new creatures in Christ Jesus, and we've got the mind of Jesus Christ, so we cannot think like ourselves. We got to think like Jesus thinks now, right? And so in order for that to take place, you got to spend time with the Father, and you got to say, God, you know I'm selfish by nature. Oh, I'm the only selfish person by nature? You say, yeah, all my selfish people wave at me. Look, ain't nobody waving. Something wrong. Y'all, okay, the rest of y'all liars. That's cool. I'll just be on the selfish side. All right? All of us want, we can be selfish. We can be ignorant. We can want more of that which we already have enough of. And God says, what is that passage, baby, you quoted today about esteeming others more highly than ourselves? Is that Philippians, the third chapter? The Bible says that we should esteem others more highly than ourselves. And so before we try to get something for us, we ask, how can we give something to somebody else? And guess what that does? It illustrates the love of God. Thank you so much. It illustrates the love of God to other people. If you see some brother or sister in need and have the means to do something about it, but turn a cold shoulder and do nothing, what happens to God's love? It disappears. And you made it disappear. When we practice real love, then we make the love of God appear. So if we want our loved ones and those of us that have friends and family members, that we want them to see the love of Jesus Christ in us, it is not going to be done through our shirts and through our bumper stickers and our bracelets. It's when we love people, when we sow into people's lives, when we help hurting people, that's when God turns around and he helps us. Amen? I got some homework for you. You ready? All right. All right. Y'all ever heard of random acts of kindness? All right. A random act of kindness is being a blessing to someone and they didn't know that you were going to bless them. All right? Being a blessing to someone and they didn't know that you were going to bless them. In other words, it is being at a restaurant and the Holy Ghost tell you, all right, pay that person's bill. You don't know them. You don't know them. I do this all the time. And so I'll have the waitress, I say, who's got that table? Well, Tina has that table. Tell Tina to come here. And I say, okay, now whatever they've ordered, if it's reasonable, praise the Lord. All right. Put that on our bill. Amen. 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 I haven't done it too many times at Chesapeake's, but I will do it at Cheddar's. Can I get a witness up in here? Amen. Y'all clap. Come on. The Lord is working on me. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Some of y'all looking at me like, well, he said he ain't doing that Applebee's. He ain't doing that Chesapeake. He did it at Cheddar. You ain't even done it at McDonald's. Oh, haters. Mother, on them cards that we have when people join, I want you to add an addendum to those cards. No haters allowed at LBC. Just put that, no haters. Make them check it. All right? So we're going to do that. Or perhaps someone is at the counter at Kroger's and they're getting some milk. You know, go up to them and say, overhear them. Say, okay, that's going to be $3.46. And you just put the $5 down there, walk off, and say, Jesus loves you. You see what I'm saying? You see how that illustrates God. When I pay for somebody's food, I take the bill and I write on it and I say, the Lord loves you. And I get out of there before they can see, because if I get the applause, if I get the credit, then God can't get the glory. Are you all understanding me? And if God doesn't get the glory, you just wasted your $32, because he will not bless you because you wasn't trying to get blessed by him. You were trying to bless yourself. You see what I'm saying? Your motives got to be right. Motives have to be right. You see somebody at school with your kids and they shoes run over. You know, find out what size shoe they wore. Well, I'm not asking you to go get the $150 Jordans. No, I'm not asking you. But go get you a nice $30 pair of shoes and give them to that teacher and say, hey, put this down in their backpack and then write on it, the Lord loves you. That's just beautiful, isn't it? That's kingdom stuff. That's kingdom stuff. And when you do that, God will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you won't have room to receive. Anybody ever tried God and you've ever blessed somebody and the blessing of God came back and overtook you. All right. Y'all finished? I'm finished, y'all. Put your hands together and give God praise. Come on, stand to your feet. Put your hands together and give God praise. How many of you are going to do something like that? I'm not asking you to spend a lot of money. You'll try that this week. You'll try that this week. I thank God for the helps ministry. I thank God for the helps ministry of this church. Man, they did something so awesome. Man, they did something so awesome. When y'all did loads of love, I said, boy, I pastored that church. They did loads of love. So what happened is they started noticing that there were a lot of transit people in our community, and they don't have the benefit of washing their clothes like we wash ours. And so instead of talking about them and saying, man, they dirty, they stink. No, what they decided to do is we gonna lease the whole, laundromat out. They leased the whole laundromat out and paid for everybody who came in there to get their clothes washed. Isn't that awesome? I think, mother, where are you, mother? Stand up. Wave, mother. I want y'all to praise God because she's always heading stuff up like that. And Summer, man, I just thank God for you all. That's the stuff that God looks for so he can know who to trust for the next level of increase. Y'all, people ask all the time, how did y'all blow up like that? Where y'all get the money to have a facility like that? How come everything y'all say you're going to do, you end up doing it? And you know what I told them? I said, our church really did not grow until we start serving the poor. Until I stopped complaining, because I sure enough was doing it. My wife will tell you, I was complaining. Ooh, I want to say something. I can't tell y'all what I was saying, but I said, them don't get no money. And man, they'll send me the finance report, and I say, for real, all them colored folk in that building, and that's all we got. I said, they don't get no money. And I was complaining to God in prayer, and God, you having me call me to serve all these people, and they take us and they ain't give us, and they take us and they ain't give us. He says, if you will start being a giver and complaining that they're not giving, then I'll start blessing you. So I said, okay, I got that. I got that revelation. I pulled the staff together. I said, this is what we're going to start doing. We're going to start giving to this community. We're going to start being a blessing to this community. So we start doing stuff like Miracles on Magnolia. First thing we did was Breakthrough on Broadway. Y'all, anybody here been here long enough to remember Breakthrough on Broadway? Breakthrough on Broadway is I went down on Broadway and saw those homeless people out there. And I noticed, I hate women with chipped nails. I don't hate women, which I hate chipped nails on women. Let me say that right. I don't know why. I chip nail polish. That's what it aggravates me. It ain't sexy. You know what I'm saying? It's just, I go in there and surprise my mother Hartwell. I go in there and surprise my mama, just show up, and she put her feet up under the couch. She know I got something to say. Now, you get a whooping and be in my house with some chipped nails. As long as you're not my wife, you ain't gonna get no whooping, but I might say something. All right? So I noticed that, and I was down there praying, I looked at them the chipped nails, and I said, just because they're homeless doesn't mean they don't want to look beautiful. I said, you know what we're going to do? We're going to go down there and do nails for the women down there. And the more we talk about, like, well, let's don't just do nails. Let's bring some clothes. And then we said, well, let's just don't bring clothes. Let's do hair. And then, well, let's don't just do hair. Let's do food. Let's just do a carnival. And that thing ended up $14,000. And guess how much we paid? Nothing. Nothing. When people started hearing what we wanted to do for that transit community, they just started throwing money at us. And that's when the floodgates opened for our ministry. And God should start blessing us. And so that's what this church will always be, a church that's a giving church. It will, because that's the only way I'm going to keep it packed in here. Y'all don't come here for my preaching, man. Y'all ain't come here for the singing. God is leading you here because he has watched us help hurting people. And there is no secret. What God can do, what he's done for OBC. Bump somebody and tell him he's going to do it for you. Amen. Father, we thank you and we bless you for this day. We honor you, God, for what you've done. Now, God, move by your spirit. I pray, Lord, that if there be somebody in this place, God, that doesn't know you in the free pardon of their sin, Lord, that you would save them as only you could do. You and you alone are worthy of our praise. And God, many of us have been poor in the natural, but all of us have been poor in the spirit. All of us have needed you, and we didn't know how to get you. And this is the opportunity that we have, Lord, to not only grow in our prosperity, but also grow in our relationship with you. So, Father, I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to do the same thing you've been doing every week. Save today. Because even if they get money, but they don't get you, they're still in a mess. For what shall it profit a man to gain this whole world and lose their own soul? And even if they give money, but they don't receive your Savior, God, they cannot have eternal life. So, Lord, I'm asking you to help. I'm asking you to draw them to yourself as only you can do. Everybody grab somebody's hand. Every head is bowed. Every eye is closed. Listen to me, my brother, my sister. Every head is bowed. Every eye is closed. Listen to me, my brothers and sisters. I don't care what you've done in the last year or 2 years or all your life, man. You may be living a life that's just wow. Don't even matter. God said he'll save you today if you want to be saved. Don't listen to these religious people that tells you you have to get it together in order for God to come into your life. You cannot clean a fish until you catch him. So God is trying to catch you today. Today, my brothers and sisters, if you're 99.9% sure that you're saved, but that's that small percentage to say, look, Pastor, man, I ain't exactly sure what would happen to me if I were to die. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed time. Don't wait till next week to try to give your life to Jesus. You may not have a next week. Just yesterday, I buried, I think, a 79-year-old lady who was born again. Just yesterday. But Wednesday, I've got to bury a 20-something-year-old kid. In the same building, in the same place. The coffin will be in the same place. You know what that says to me? You don't have to be old to die. And just like you didn't know your birth date before you were born, you won't know your death date till you die. So my brother, my sister, I offer Christ to you. That's the only reason God called me to preach. Not to make you shout. To make sure that you get out of hell. So this is the best part of the service. To give people the opportunity to have life. And that life more abundantly. So every head is bowed, every eye is closed. I don't care if you are a pastor. I don't care if you're a preacher. I don't care if you're on the worship team or on the cameras or diaconate or your mother, I want you to look inside of your heart and say, you know what? I'm not poor in my pocketbook, but I might be poor in my spirit. I might be a millionaire in the natural, but a poverty stricken in my spirit, and I need Jesus. Because the millionaire needs Jesus too. My brother, my sisters, I offer Christ to you. So when I count to three, if you're not 100% sure that you're saved, I want you just to squeeze somebody's hand. I'm not going to ask you to come up. I'm not going to give you the mic. But I am not going to ask you to come up and take the mic and testify. But I am going to ask you to squeeze somebody's hand because you got to make a decision. It can't be just in your heart. Because if whatever you will not do in public, you ain't going to do in private anyway. So my brother, my sister, if I'm talking to you and you say, hey, Pastor, I think I'm saved, but I'm not 100% sure, and I need to make sure, I want you to squeeze that hand when I count to three. Second group of people, you're saying, Pastor, I'm saved, man, but I do have a problem. I'm without a church home, and I need a church home. And I'm going to say something real radical to you today. Many of you have been coming to this church for 4 years, four years. You actually followed us here from Fifth Avenue, and you've been asking every week, should I join that church? Should I join that church? Why you come every week if you're still asking that question? I'm going to ask you to stop dating us. I'm going to ask you to stop making us your weekend thing and commit. Can we get married today where you're not just benefiting, but the ministry benefits also? Because you're never going to walk in the blessing of God until you make up your mind where you need to be rooted anyway. My brother, my sister, if that's you, I want you to join this ministry. The third group of people, you're saying, Pastor, look, I'm saved. I got a church, but it's in Memphis or it's in Charlotte or it's in Nashville. It's in Chattanooga, Murfreesboro. Man, I'm here for college or I'm here working and I'm going to be here for a couple of years or even just a year, but I need somebody to cover me until I go back to my pastor. If that's you, come under watch care. When I count to three, if you're in one of those three categories, I just want you to squeeze somebody's hand. Father, I've done all I can do. No man can come lest he be drawn by you. Are y'all ready to receive the greatest gift that you've ever been offered? And that is the Son, Jesus Christ. If you're ready, when I count to three and you're in one of those three categories, I don't want you to wait. I just want you to squeeze somebody's hand and squeeze it tight, saying, it's me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. This is nothing embarrassing. Man, this is celebratory. You're about to get the greatest gift that you could ever get. Better than a Benz, better than a Bentley, better than $1 billion. It's Jesus who gives you all the blessings of God. One, don't let the enemy keep you bound another day of your life. Two, pride cometh before destruction and a haughty heart before a great fall. Are you ready? Three, squeeze that hand and squeeze it tight. Make your decision to follow Jesus and walk in the fullness of what God created you to walk in. Squeeze it again right now. Squeeze it tight now. If somebody squeezed your hand, I want you to lift that hand straight up in the air all over the building. I see you, my sister. I see you, my sister. I see you, my sister. I see you, my brother. I see you, my brother. I see you, my sister. 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 I see you, my brother. I see you, my sister. I see you, my sister. I see you, my brother. Everybody that has a hand lifted, whether somebody lifted your hand or you lifted theirs, come to this altar right quick, and I want everybody else praising God like they lost their mind. Because when one repents, the word of God says that the Holy Ghost and the angels celebrate. Come on, let's give him praise. I don't want you to stop clapping until the last person hits this altar. Come on, keep your hands together. Keep your hands together. Keep your hands together. This is an Easter harvest right here. This is an Easter harvest right here. Keep your hands together. Keep your hands together. For Jesus.